Second, good morning again. The second lecture is on eDNA, environmental DNA, which is an emerging tool to monitor biodiversity for conservation. So this is an DNA technology which is available to date for biodiversity conservation. For biodiversity conservation, now people are working on assessing the diversity first. What are the organisms present? What are the organisms which is not endangered? Something like that. So in order to assess the environment, DNA as, using DNA is a tool. It is. It has been there for a long time. But earlier people were doing it by species by species. So traditionally, biodiversity assessment was done by counting the number of species present in a given environment or given place in a unit space, how many species are present. That was the way by which biodiversity is measured. But later when DNA technologies came into, people started finding out what are the species present in that, but say for example a soil sample, how many microorganisms are present in the soil sample. So what they can do is isolate DNA from the soil sample and then do some analysis of ribosomal RNA analysis or some genes which are of specific to the there are some DNA marker genes available for a difference. For plants there is some mitochondria, some chloroplast genes available, RBCL. For mitochondrial genes in the animals, some like that. These markers can be used and then the DNA amplified. And then you can do gradient gel to find out how many such variants are present in that. That variation will tell how many such species are present in that. So this biodiversity conservation is needed to protect the land, and then in order to protect the natural resources and to maintain some rare ecosystem, and then to maintain the habitat and the benefit out of that. I don't have to mention it. So when you conserve the nature, the benefits is reaped by human being only. But sometimes because of the exploitation of the nature by over use of recreations, like you can see in Western Ghats exploited over for some resorts built in the elephant pathway or something like that. So overuse of the natural system will lead to some species extinct or endangering certain species. But we are, we are looking at the big picture, big animals, which we can see like tiger or elephant, like that we see. But there are so many other organisms which are present in nature, and that indirectly help these macrobia, microbes which help these macro organisms, and how can they be assessed? So eDNA is the current solution for monitoring the biodiversity in the environment. Environmental DNA is organismal DNA that can be found in the environment. eDNA is nothing but environment DNA. Environmental DNA originates from cellular material shed by organisms. So it is for a eukaryotic organism like skin, excrement, etc., can also have some amount of DNA. They can be shed into an aquatic environment or into a terrestrial environment that can be sampled and monitored using new molecular methods. So eDNA is the DNA which is present in the environment. Sometimes if it is a microbial system, that full microorganism will contain the DNA, you can isolate. But for a eukaryotic organism also can be used, assessed by the eDNA. Because we all, as I mentioned, the hair will be shed or skin will be shed by the organism, or fecal matter will have some of the tissues, dead tissues. Even in like tiger counting, they used farm prints, or sometimes they use fecal material, similarly for elephant also. And for counting the tiger, whether they are different than, are we counting the one again and again? We don't want to have such anomalies. So that DNA will be there, because fingerprint of the DNA will be specific for each and every species, as well as for individual also. Environmental DNA is used to identify species in water bodies. In water bodies, as well as in a terrestrial system also, it can be used. So the chemical structure of the DNA is the same for all organisms. So how can we identify the different organism using the DNA? It is going to be same for all, but the sequences, the variation present in the sequences, DNA sequences, let us know that it is DNA from a tiger or from a microorganism or from a plant or something. The DNA will tell. So when you sequence the DNA only, you can find out whether this is. Earlier, people were using some mitochondrial genes or chloroplast genes to identify the species, or ribosomal RNA genes. That is a standard marker that will be used to find out. So we can assess the number of species present in a given environment, and not only the number of species, we can also find out the abundance of the species. So how will you identify the abundant, or how will you identify the abundance of the species? So if you have a technology to distinguish what is the amount of DNA, particular type of DNA present in excess or in less amount, that will tell how much is the, how could be the numbers present in the ecological sample. Traditional method of species monitoring involves visual surveys and conducting of individuals in the field using distinct morphological characters. Say in a water body, if you collect some water, you will have small organisms floating around. Some of them you can identify if you are a zoologist, and some of them you may not be, because some young ones will be similar for many, or it will overlap the morphology. In that case, very difficult to identify morphologically. So there, these are the constraints of the traditional method of species monitoring. Phenotypic plasticity and closely related species with very similar appearance in juvenile stages. When they are young, they look, this tadpole of a frog will be similar to the other stage of, looks like a fish. So some people, trained eye only can differentiate that. Layman cannot differentiate. So very difficult to count the numbers, how many species are there. Invasive on the species or ecosystem under study. So for example, you want to find out the species abundance or species present in a particular ecosystem or in a river. You have different layers of the river. So if you have to actually count, you may have to dive inside and then collect the bottom layer, middle layer, like that. And then when you take it out, and then you have to quantify it. Sometimes it is possible to quantify in that system itself. Sometimes we have to remove it. It is an invasive procedure. And once you have taken it out, and then that is a destructive procedure also. Marine surveys that has relied on highly destructive techniques. So you cannot stay there and count and then record it. Only thing you can maybe capture it through a camera, but exact numbers if you want to find out, and if you cannot differentiate the species, then you may have to differentiate through some other means of like DNA test or something like that, then it will be a destructive procedure only. Morphological identification is heavily dependent on taxonomic expertise. So nowadays, these taxonomic experts are also in the decline, and so it is very difficult to count the number of species, how many different species, identify them, and then counting is very. Alternate approaches would be by DNA. So biodiversity monitoring by retrieving DNA from environmental samples. So that is eDNA. eDNA is the best solution to identify the species and identify the abundance of the species. DNA from higher organisms persist in the environment. So not only for a lower organism like microorganism or like diatoms, we will see some of the examples in the coming slides. So DNA from higher organisms persist in the environment as a dead tissue or some excreta or skin, hair, something like that. So DNA, if you have a sample from a terrestrial sample or from a water body, you can filter it and then collect the solid particles and then isolate DNA from that and then distinguish them which species they belong to. So it can be sampled extracted and analyzed. And as species interact with the environment, they will continuously expel DNA into the surrounding. So yeah, a given environment sample will reflect the richness of the species present in that environment. For higher organisms, this DNA may come from excreted cells or tissues such as urine, fecus, feces, hairs, skin, and from dead individuals leaking genetic material. So some carcasses lying around in the water body or in the terrestrial area, that also will leak some DNA. So the microbial DNA comes from microbes. Microbial, all the other eukaryotes are small planktons or so, may in some system exists predominantly inside mitochondria. So the eukaryotic DNA exists in genome as well as in mitochondria, and some, if it is plant, it is in the chloroplast also. How will it get out? So membrane degradation, that also happens in the environment. Sometimes it will be degraded and then it will be available as extracellular DNA in the environment. Otherwise, during the process of isolating DNA, we have to take care of that also, because there are some eukaryotic cells also present in this environmental sample. Means then you have to think about membrane degradation for letting out the DNA, because sometimes mitochondrial DNA becomes very good candidate for identifying the difference between species. Once the DNA is left in the environment, its preservation and this availability varies with several order of magnitude. So ecological sample or environmental sample, once the DNA is available, how much is available in each DNA? Whether two environments can have the same amount of eDNA, we don't know. So that will be the real result when you analyze them, how much of each different species are present in that. So that is how we are looking at it. In the eDNA, if we think for a particular environment, this many species existed there, and if they exist in more numbers, the availability of DNA also will be more. But in the last of this lecture, we will also see the some of the challenges, what happens to the DNA, all those things are also there. But to date, at present, DNA is the best method to analyze the species richness and abundance. DNA, why it is a good candidate? Because DNA is stable. It can stay for in weeks in temperate conditions and water, to hundreds and thousands of years in cold and dry permafrost. So at the tundra like north poles and south pole, where extreme cold conditions are there, this DNA can stay for more than 100 years. So DNA is stable. This is the point which I want to reiterate here. eDNA can be used to For raising or answering questions related to fundamental research questions related to molecular biology, ecology, paleontology, and environmental science. Now, in this, we are using as a tool for monitoring the environment. So it is an environmental question. Paleontology means we saw here that it can be safe for years or hundreds of thousands of years. So how each organism evolved, all those things, evolutionarily, how they are related, where they came from, whether they are aquatic organism which evolved into a terrestrial organism, something like that. And different ecology can be understood by the amount of species richness in the ecological sample. The difference will reflect on it. Methods to analyze the DNA. The content of an eDNA sample is typically analyzed by amplification. By polymerase chain reaction, I think now everybody will be aware of, because in schools itself, they are teaching polymerase chain reaction. So it is a method to amplify the DNA. And once you have amplified the DNA, then you can sequence it. Why you want to amplify? Because whenever you isolate DNA from a soil sample or a water sample, the amount of DNA may not be sufficient for sequencing. So you amplify. Earlier, when you want to identify or characterize the microbes present in the water in a given water ecosystem, what people do is they just take that and then culture it. But the culturing may not be equivalent to the ecological situation. So that is the disadvantage of that procedure. So that can be overcome by the amplification methods. Whatever sample DNA available in that sample will be amplified, and that will be sequenced. So it will be the true representation of what is present in the original sample. But if you culture, if you have a culture technique in the middle, that say, because there will be aerobic organisms present, anaerobic organisms, facultative, all these present, but whatever condition you give may not be equivalent to the condition which exists in the nature. So when you culture an organism, multiply the organism in vitro, that is not a real reflection of what exists in the environmental sample. So eDNA is the best solution. Whatever you collect from the environment, you isolate DNA directly and then amplify the DNA and then sequence it. So the amplification is done either by a single species approach or by a multiple species. Single species approach means, say for example, if you have a species specific primer, it will amplify only one DNA. But in your environmental sample, you will have more all the five kingdom may be present in that sample. So you have to use a generic primer so that all of them get amplified. And then after amplification, when you sequence, you will find out individually, after looking at the sequence, you can see how many different organisms are present in that. So this is a improved version of DNA analysis. Next generation sequencing technologies has made comprehensive biodiversity surveys possible for limited effort and cost. The cost of next gen sequencing has come down, and then time taken for performing this next gen is also lesser compared to the traditional analysis of PCR amplification. In next gen also, there is an initial step is amplification only, PCR amplification, and then sequencing it. DNA metabarcoding is done for complex samples, a mass DNA sequencing for the simultaneous molecular identification of multiple taxa in a complex sample is possible. So this term you have to keep in mind. So this is a new terminology which in the late 90s and early 21st century, DNA metabarcoding. Earlier it is DNA analysis or PCR analysis or biodiversity analysis, that is the conventional method of DNA analysis. But barcoding also in 90s you can have barcoding, you will with specific enzymes or like cytochrome oxidase or Rubisco, all these proteins will be amplified for different category of organism, and then there will be single nucleotide polymorphism that will tell what organism they belong to. So this is a schematic diagram of global ecosystem and biodiversity monitoring with environmental DNA metabarcoding. So what could be the different type of samples and what could be the organisms present in the different type of sample is given here. The eDNA metabarcoding for biomonitoring. So biomonitoring is part of conservation. So only when you know what are the organisms or what are the species prevalent in that and what are the species which are scarce in nature, that will tell you the nature of the environment, as well as that will help too for policymakers or for some strategy building. So specimens and biofilms, these are there you can have eukaryotes, nematodes, diatoms, and planktons in this category. In the water, you can have all these eukaryotes, prokaryotes, fungi, protists, plants, vertebrates, fish. This is in the water sample. And in sediments, you can have eukaryotes, metazoans, invertebrates, fungi, protists, and plankton. So carrion flies, mammals, birds, and reptiles, specimens and symbioses. So these are different type of terrestrial samples you can have. Estuarine is a place where the river meets the sea, and that place also you have some sediments, and in the sediments you can have all those things. In the freshwater, you have plankton, larvae, macroinvertebrate, microbes, all those things. In the water, these are the fish, amphibian, reptile, all these are. So these are a mixture of organism or a complex mixture of starting from prokaryote to prokaryote. Sometimes archaebacteria also may there, proteobacteria, all the bacteria may be there. So yeah, unique enzyme or DNA coding for specific species cannot be used. So you have to just amplify the DNA using random primers and then use that DNA for sequencing. That next gen sequencing is the only method by which you can barcode them. So barcoding is finding out specific sequence for a specific species. So meta eDNA meta barcoding is possible by next gen sequencing method alone. So how this eDNA barcoding is used in different fields. So one, this in this earlier, the first slide we had is for conservation. So this is also for monitoring. This is also part of conservation. So if for conservation, you have to monitor the system, ecosystem, and then only you can make some decision on how to conserve different things which are endangered or which are extinct. So you can also measure the ancient ecosystem. We will see another picture. Ancient, see already we saw in a lower temperature. Temperate condition, it can stay for months. In a permafrost or tundra conditions or minus degrees, it can DNA can stay stable for hundreds of years. So ancient ecosystem can also be measured using DNA meta barcoding, and then plant pollinator interaction. And when you have say pollen deposited or by the insects or different, which one is the pollinator and which is prevalent in that, which can be a potential pollinator. All these questions can be analyzed by the pollens attached to different insects. We can identify, and then if from honey also we can identify honey barcoding. You can identify or from in the honey bee, you can have the different pollen sources can be identified, and then plant pollinator interaction can be identified by insect and plant relationship and diet analysis. So what species is prevalent and how it can be exploited for maintaining the ecosystem. Diet analysis is which one, say it is a plant, and if it is extinct or when it is a drought means, then this will be less. Then naturally this will come down. This population will come down. If it comes down, naturally this. So the diet analysis for maintaining the balance of a ecosystem can be done by the DNA present in this particular environment. And then invasive species detection. Sometimes a new novel, if you have two or three samples from that environment and one or two places, you may have an extra species that is an invasive. And sometimes it will overtake the existing species. So the DNA will reflect that, which is the invasive species. If it is a natural species, then it may be present in that environment or several other environments. So how this species invaded and the reason, it will be found out, and then quarantine measures will be taken care of. All those things, for this application also you need a DNA monitoring, DNA based monitoring. Pollution response, so when a region is highly polluted, the number of species present in that region will come down. So that will tell, so for monitoring whether the pollution level is high or low or medium or it is normal, why the some species are abundant and when some species are less, something like that. So this is also to maintain the balance and of the ecosystem. So air quality monitoring can also be done by the collecting samples from the air and then using that for DNA. So small particles that may have pollen, spores, different things which are suspended in the air can be used. So these are some of the applications of eDNA barcoding. So classical DNA barcoding normally takes mitochondrial or chloroplast or ribosomal RNA genes that will be amplified by PCR, sequenced and subsequently used as a barcode. When you sequence, you will identify which species it belong to. This DNA meta barcoding, it cannot efficiently utilize these cytochrome oxidase or because some of this DNA is from environmental sample and some may not be in a stable variable nature. So any DNA which is available has to be amplified, and then it has to be sequenced and then found out. So it would be a random primer rate. So more than 500 base pair and seem to reach the. So if your barcode is 500 base pair long, if you randomly you amplify the whole total DNA, eDNA, and then randomly amplification is also done by random primers, and then sequencing also performed using some next gen sequencing methods that will use some adapters also. And then if you have a stretch of DNA which is more than 500 base pair long, easily you can spot the species. So that is how the DNA metabarcoding works. Mitochondrial, earlier mitochondrial primers are used for animals, and then Rubisco, RBCL is for plants, and maturase K is also used for plants sometimes, and or most of the time, both do simultaneously. Internal transcribed spacer regions for fungi. These are specific primers, but metabarcoding includes this as well as it includes the other DNA, intergenic DNA amplification. So from any such DNA, if you have a stretch of more than 500 base pair, easily you can spot the species. These target high, these things target high resolution at the species level, but high copy number per cell of mitochondria, chloroplast, rRNA genes also make them useful in eDNA studies. So these things are also, earlier ones are also exploited in eDNA barcoding or meta barcoding, and then intergenic region also. So this is one paper which I have given reference at the end, and they are also using eDNA barcoding for ancient, knowing the ancient history, or and some of them aquatic environment. So the legend for this, so they have glaciers, permafrost, tundra, aquatic sediment, lake and streams, terrestrial habitats, ocean. So these three, the first three are from ancient, these three, and these are current aquatic. So sample isolation, they are color coded differently. Sample isolations, it is blue color, and then DNA isolation is green color, and then after that PCR amplification, so this orange color coded. So this is the steps involved in that. Orange is PCR amplification, and then they have used the Illumina MiSeq sequencing technology, that is a next gen sequencing technique, bioinformatic data. Once you have sequenced them, and then you have to find out the species. How will you find out? You have to refer them with the database available. So if there is nothing to compare of what you have generated, then it is you cannot find out the organism. So always it is better to have some sequence, referral sequence in the database. So if the database does not contain any matching sequences, then you cannot find out. So exactly, if you have to pinpoint them, then each and every organism, full genome sequence available or part of the sequence available, you are lucky. Otherwise, you have to do that enriching the database with individually sequencing that organism and then depositing in the database. That's how it works. eDNA from microorganism, culture-based methods grossly misrepresent the composition. Already I have brought this topic. When you culture the microorganism, that may not be a true representation of what existed in the nature. So eDNA thus represents a unique access to the information on the genetic map. So here you don't culture it in the between, you just amplify the eDNA. eDNA from microorganisms has since been studied extensively in soil, permafrost, freshwater, seawater. So these are some of the samples in which eDNA barcoding is extensively used. eDNA from macroorganisms. So already we mentioned eDNA also contain eukaryotic organisms like eukaryotic or fishes or different forms of organism which exist in aquatic system or terrestrial system, and their dead tissue or different tissues are present in that. Sometimes they may be present within the mitochondria or different compartments, but if their membranes are degraded, they will come out as extracellular DNA. Prokaryotes and microbial eukaryotes as a form present only as part of the organism. So cellular remains are free DNA. So extracellular DNA or the DNA present in the dead cells. that can be used for eDNA from. So this is the workflow for barcoding. So field sampling, sampling handling, laboratory processing, bioinformatic analysis. So field sampling is collection of the sample. So in that itself, you have to be careful that you have to wash everything, decontaminate. Because if you collect some samples and then there are already, it is contaminated with some microorganism, means that will only be dominating in your sample. So there are methods how to collect a terrestrial sample, how to collect water sample, all those things. And then you have to sampling, how you subsample it and then make it that it is representative or one or two. So for the area, you will have this many samples you might need. So in order to get a concordant result, so that is also some statistics is also involved. Sometimes the DNA in the extraction, in the laboratory procedure, some contamination is possible. That also, if you have a good laboratory practices, the clean technology available, then that may not be there. So PCR is a very sensitive technique in which even a small nanogram or picogram of DNA can be amplified. So that amount of DNA should also be not present in the sample as contaminant. So that is that has to be taken care of. Once you have done PCR amplification and amplicon library preparation, then if you have sequenced it, then you need some tools for either for amplified product, or if you have a sequence of the DNA, then you need lot of softwares to analyze the sequence. And some of them are here, Galaxy. For next gen sequencing methods, you need that. This is a workflow for a diatom sample, which is a sediment. You can see here our biofilm sampling. It is in a rock. There are some mosses or diatoms which are present that they are taking with the help of a brush and then transferring into a. So from that biofilm sampling, they have taken total DNA extraction and barcode PCR amplification. So from that, they are using some specific primers. And then if they suspect some species, and just or some question is whether the species is present or what are the diatoms present, if that is the question, so all the possible diatoms that is expected from a freshwater or a marine water, accordingly they will have primer set. And then barcode PCR amplification is known sample amplification. So high throughput sequencing and bioinformatics. So you can see here that species 1, 3, 5, all the sequences are here DNA barcodes for the particular species. So only with the reference database, if they match, then you can say they are available. So quality is how whether the sequences which you have obtained is matching, and then it's a clean sequence, and then it matches perfectly with the database sequences, then you can have quality index, taxonomic list, and ecological status. This also is with the abundance, how much of that DNA is. Sometimes it is based on the peak of the product amplified. The challenges with the DNA method is contamination. The risk of contamination and the possibility of false positive result is also always there. So contamination should be removed. Already in the methodology we saw that it has to be decontaminated, because other microbials may be attached to the sample. So we don't want that to reflect in the sequence. So we have to clean it and then collect the sample. And then cross-contamination. If you are collecting sample from two or three different locations or sites, and then if you use the same equipment for collecting the sample, there is a possibility of cross-contamination that you have to minimize. So they have to be sanitized or cleaned and then sample collected. And lab contamination is while you are doing PCR eDNA studies, because it is a very sensitive technique that only helps us to identify all the organism, but that is the defect the challenge also. If there is a small amount of contamination, then that will be reflected there. But this is also the positive as well as negative side of PCR. So even very small amount of DNA can also be amplified, and you can identify that species also. The use of NGS technology. So in PCR amplification and then NGS next gen sequencing method is the best method for eDNA barcoding, because simultaneously you can look into several species. So And even in NGS technologies, the initial stages are amplification of DNA. So you have to have certain control reactions for finding out that there is no cross-contamination, or say you have DNA extraction blanks. Sometimes you may have to have negative controls, PCR blanks as well as field blanks to monitor contamination in the is essential. So in any PCR, always we will have a positive control and a negative control. Positive control will tell that the experiment is going to work. Negative control will tell that it is not contaminated, the ingredients are not contaminated. For that, we will have negative control. So without DNA, we will run some samples which do not give an amplification. So apart from that, there are some challenges of inhibition. Sometimes when you collect DNA from soil or sometimes from a sediment, then the humic acid content, humic acid is rich in the compost area, or where, because in a natural system all the organisms live and die, so that humic acid is part of that dead material, and if they are present in that, then DNA isolation may be challenging. If the DNA isolation is challenging, then it cannot tell what are the species present in that. So you may have to use some other procedures to get rid of that. But nowadays there are some commercial kits available for isolation of DNA from various environmental samples that will take care of all these inhibitions, inhibitory substances which are present in the environmental sample. So, and the next challenge is errors when you are sequencing. So the erroneous DNA sequences will give rise to biased result. So sequencing technology which you use also should be the best technology, and that should not during the process of sometimes process of amplification, sometimes during the process of sequencing. One in 1,000 or one in 10,000, there may be an error possible. So if you use PCR polymerases, which are proofreading capacity, PFU polymerases for amplification and for sequencing, then you may not encounter all these errors. So the reference databases. So once you have sequenced the eDNA, now you have to compare it with the existing database to identify the species. So for the database, the GenBank database is growing on a day-to-day basis. So always it is possible to identify the organisms. But sometimes if you have a novel species which is present, it could be an invasive species or it may be an ancient species. For that, people have not done any experiment or there is no sequence deposited in the GenBank, then you may not find it. So DNA barcodes for all the fishes available in this database, all the total DNA is available in GenBank. For fish, this is the database. For mammals, this is a database. And bird species, this is a database. So COIM is cytochrome oxidase. That gene is used for all the animals. And those sequences will be available. And then that will clearly tell what species it belongs to. If they are not available, then our experiment will not match it with any species. So in that case, we have to characterize it and then give at least ribosomal RNA sequence or some of this cytochrome oxidase. All that sequence information, at least we have to deposit in the database and enrich the database. So the next time when somebody else is using that, then they will get a hit, and then that will be numbered, or the abundance, all that species will be identified. Use of eDNA for inventory and monitoring, improved detection of native species. So it is a cost-effective method, and then a simple method, and small, rare, secretive, and other species that are difficult to detect. So this is a method suitable for these cases. And detection of species using eDNA may improve biodiversity assessments and provide information about status, distribution, and habitat requirement for lesser known species. There are some early detection invasive species. Okay, for this also, invasive species, if they enter an ecosystem, that may ruin the full environment. But in the earlier stage itself, if you identify, because it is more sensitive, even one or two samples of that or cells or tissues of that present in, that will tell, let us know. So there is, here boat ballast water. Say in the boat, the bottom, there will be some water used for balancing it. And that will contain contains some of the species present in that water, and when the boat moves to a different place, then there is a possibility of exchanging that material, and that becomes an invasive for that place. So that is one reason how this invasive species are spreaded all around. And then in future, whether eDNA can it be relied? So some challenges are there, like some of the DNA. Already I said hundreds of years it can be stable, but sometimes adverse conditions like high temperature, high pH, or something like that, if it is present in that, then the DNA may not be stable. So in that case, you may not have the representation of the DNA, and then because the DNA represents the species, you may not assess it properly. So eDNA, that is the challenge in so. And also sometimes if it is a say different organism, you can identify, but what is the source of that DNA, you cannot identify. Say for example, yes, fish, whether the DNA is obtained from the dead tissues present in the feces or a carcass available in that near neighborhood or something like that. You cannot find out that. Only thing you can, after isolating DNA, you can identify the species, but source of the DNA cannot be identified. Sometimes if you want to monitor closely, you want to identify whether the species is alive or it is dead, something like that. In that case, eDNA barcoding will not help because you cannot identify the source. And as I mentioned, adverse climatic conditions may not allow the DNA to be stable. So in that case, the DNA may be degrading. And depending on the locality, the amount of eDNA isolated may vary. And because of the constraint of the poor quality DNA, the representation of the full species present and then in that DNA may not be available. So these are the two papers which I referred for this presentation. One is from Global Ecology and Conservation, another is Biological Conservation. This is a review paper on past, present and future perspectives of environmental DNA metabarcoding review, and this is an emerging tool in conservation of monitoring past and present biodiversity. So DNA in a complex sample was discussed in this lecture. For example, earlier DNA analysis was available for gene by gene basis, but this approach allows you to get the environmental sample and get DNA as a whole. That DNA, you call it as eDNA, and that DNA can be used for amplification and then sequencing. After getting the sequencing, you match it with the database and find out what are the species present in that and how much they are present depending on the availability of the DNA. And these are some of the applications of eDNA metabarcoding. Okay, thank you.